Join me in prayer, please. Our Heavenly Father, for this time that you've given us to worship, we're grateful. And help us, Lord, to remember who we're worshiping as we enter this house. We pray for forgiveness of our sins and shortcomings. We ask, God, that you would continue to remind us of our sinful nature. You've told us in your word, when we confess our sins to you, you're just to forgive us, so we ask for that now. Prepare us, God, to hear your word today. Open our minds and hearts that we would hear it. And then, Lord, as we hear, that we wouldn't be hearers only, but we would be doers your word as we go out into our different places that we live each day, and that we would be a living witness for you, and that others would see Jesus in us, and that you would be glorified. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. Now, clarify one thing. I'm not Lewis Penfield, for some of y'all that might have wondered about that, but Lewis did call, and he said, please don't tell him that it's not me. He said, I'd like to, you know, look like you for one time. So if that's it's like those of us who have grandkids, you know, we take our grandkids out. We're kind of ashamed to do it because we make all the other grandkids look so bad. But we do that anyway. So I'm in for Lewis today, and I want to welcome all of you to our service today. If you are visiting for the first time, there's a little pamphlet that's right in front of you on the pew, in front of you on the back of the pew. We'd like for you to take that and fill it out. And we'll pick it up when the offering plates are passed, and we'll have a record of your visit. Also, if you need a ride to church, you don't have a ride, if you'll call our church office at 359-4077, we'll be glad to come by and bring you in here, and we'll get you back as well. Now, at this time, we'd like for you to stand up and greet those around you, please.
Thank you. morning and welcome. Welcome to church this morning. I want to talk to you guys this morning about a gentleman you may not have heard much about. His name was Jeremiah. And in the Bible, Jeremiah was called by God to be a prophet. But you know what was special about Jeremiah? He was very young. He was very young. He was just a little kid when God called him. So I'm going to read you a passage about Jeremiah. The word of the Lord came to me saying, I am your creator. Before you were born, I set you apart, and I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Oh, sovereign Lord, I said, I do not know how to speak. I'm only a child. But the Lord said to me, don't say I'm only a child. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Don't be afraid of them, for I'm with you, and I will rescue you. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, now, I put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. God reached out and touched Jeremiah and told him, don't be afraid. Go out, say what I've told you to say. Tell the people about me and my love for them. And you know what? He tells all of us to do that too. Now, you may say, but I'm just a kid, just like Jeremiah said. Well, we all like to make excuses, but God told Jeremiah not to make excuses about being a kid. And we shouldn't do that either. Whether you're in preschool, kindergarten, first through 12th grade, college, or even some of us older folks need to hear this too. You can talk to people about God and his love for them. You can show them through the way you live and the things you do. And you know what? You don't have to be afraid, because God will tell you what to say. You'll know. It'll happen. I've had people tell me, I can never do what you do. Well, you know, sometimes I leave from up here and I don't know what I said, because I didn't come up with those words. God gave them to me. And he'll take care of you just that way. So never, ever be afraid, no matter how young, no matter how old, to share the love of God with somebody. Okay? Let's say our prayers. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we just praise you for all the blessings you pour out on us, Lord. And we know that no matter who we are, where we are, how old or how young we are, Lord, you will be right there beside us, Lord. And we trust in you to tell us exactly what we need to say and when we need to say it, Lord. We ask you to be with us through this day and touch someone's heart today that they might know you better. We ask these things in your name. Amen.
Good morning. Blessed to be here with y'all this morning. I know the Lord has some special way he's going to touch each one of us somewhere this morning, so be ready. We're going to start off in Romans. If you'll turn with me to page 965 in your pew Bible, we're at Romans 12, verses 1 through 8. That's page 965. Therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may discern what is the good, pleasing, and perfect will of God. For by the grace given to me, I tell everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he should think. Instead, think sensibly, as God has distributed a measure of faith to each one. Now, as we have many parts in one body, and all the parts do not have the same function, in the same way, we who are the many are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. According to the grace given to us, we have different gifts. If prophecy, use it according to the standard of faith. If service, in service. If teaching, in teaching. If exhorting, in exhortation. Giving, with generosity. Leading, with diligence. showing mercy with cheerfulness. May the Lord bless the reading and hearing of his word. Thank you.
Before we pray, I want to make you aware of a very special guest we have in the house today. Her name is Chloe, and she's a furry little fella, and she's sitting with Jackie Barnes. And now she's cute as a button, and you're going to want to pet her and talk to her and all of that stuff. But she is working. She is a working dog. She's a service dog. And so when you see her here, know that she is working, and know, don't touch. And don't watch her, because it will distract her from the job that she is doing right now. It's a very important thing that she's doing for Jackie today, and I just wanted to let you know that so that you'll not be disturbed or disappointed if you can't play with the dog, okay? I do okay? Okay, thank you. Let's bow together. Let's pray. Our Father, we are grateful to know you. We rejoice in who you are. We give thanks for all that you do. We thank you for giving us the gift of eternal life in our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that by your mercies you urge us to present our bodies to you as a living sacrifice. You promise that we will no longer be conformed to this age, but that we can be transformed people. And every one of us in this place longs to have a transformed life, longs to grow and mature, to grow in grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We long to bring him to the world in which we live, to present Jesus to our neighbors and friends, and the salvation that comes in him and him alone. We thank you for the magnificent grace, mercy, and peace that is ours in him. We thank you for an abundance of power, an incredibly unlimited amount of power that you exert in our lives. We thank you for these moments that we spend together as the body of Christ, ministering to one another and offering our worship to you. May you be blessed. May your name be honored. May everything we say and do in this place today bring glory and praise to your name. For we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Please stand as we sing Victory to Jesus.
Save. plunge me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing up there the songs of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior, forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love plunge me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
You may be seated.
First Timothy 6:10 says, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows." Let's pray. Father, remind us every day that you own everything and that we're just stewards of the blessings that you've sent our way. Help us always to remember that we need to be a giving people, and that you've promised in your word that it's very simple, that we're to be cheerful givers and to give as we've been blessed. So guide us in our priorities as Christians, and especially as we give. For it's in your name we pray. Amen.
I want to say a word of thanks to Mary Lambert today. It's not like she's clamoring to jump back on the bench, but she comes through. She comes through for us, and she helps lead us in worship. And Mary, just thank you. Ray read from Romans chapter 12 a few moments ago. A great chapter, and if you're looking for a text of Scripture to just spend some time meditating on and thinking through, Romans 12, the whole chapter, is really a good place for you to go if you want to capture some really good insights about the nature of the spiritual life and the nature of our life together. One of the points that the passage makes is that a church is composed of many members, but is one church, one body. In the same way that your body has many different parts, many different members, and all of the members do not have the same function, but they fit together and it becomes one body. That's the uniqueness of who we are, and that's what the church is made of. That's who we are. Well, we've been talking about spiritual leadership for the last several weeks, and we've been talking about spiritual leadership in general, but we've been applying it to deacon ministry in particular, because we're in the process of nominating and electing deacons. So this next Sunday, we're going to do the final election, and in your worship folder, there are the names of five guys that are willing to have their name on the ballot to be elected and to serve as a deacon in the coming three-year term. So you want to pay attention to that, and I give you that information this week so that you can pray about your vote. Each of these guys must receive a majority plus one of the votes cast in order to be elected. So just because there are only five names and we only need five guys doesn't mean you don't have to vote for them. Please do that. That's an important thing for us to do. But pray about it. Make it a matter of your prayer life, because these guys are being called to a particular kind of service, and it's a very important service in the life in the life of the church. When we talked about spiritual leadership, the first Sunday we made a point that spiritual leaders must be born of the Spirit. The Spirit of God must inhabit these individuals in a powerful and profound way for them to be able to offer the kind of servant leadership that is required in the life of the church. The second Sunday we talked about they need to be determined to serve. Service needs to be the mindset of a spiritual leader, not the position, not the power, not anything that brings glory to self, but the opportunity to serve and give is what spiritual leadership is all about. And so last Sunday we talked about serving as you go, on the way, wherever you happen to be, offering the service that you can give in the moment. And by the way, in the moment is where we live, and in the moment is where we need to be right now, so that we can gain from God what He is offering to us through this service. Today, I want to talk specifically about the character of a deacon. I want us to think about the character of a deacon in a special kind of way today. I think you'll see what I mean by that as we get to the text of Scripture. I'm going to talk about five attributes of the character of a deacon. Five attributes. There are more than five characteristics of deacons in the passage of Scripture we're going to read together, but I've sort of condensed them down into five things that could be memorable for us, and so that's why I want to do that. But right now, before we get into the text, let's bow together and let's have a word of prayer. Our Father, as we gather in your presence, as we offer you our praise and worship, and we call upon your name, we seek your presence among us. We remember your word is light. And so we pray that you would give us eyes to see, give us ears that we may hear, give us hearts to believe. what good word you give us in this hour. In the matchless and marvelous name of Jesus, we dare to ask, and all God's people said. Would you open your Bibles with me to 1 Timothy chapter 3 and make your way to verse 1, page 1008 in the Pew Bible, if that's what you're using this morning. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. I want to talk for a first characteristic, a character quality of a deacon as being goodness. I'm going to begin at verse 1 because you'll see in a moment that verse 8 continues, likewise deacons. So whatever verse 1 has to say applies to the life of deacons, and I wanted to pick that up before we move beyond that. So 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 says, if anyone aspires to be an overseer, he has a great desire. Now let me break that word down just a little bit for you. This word that is used is akin to the word that is often translated as lust. It's basic desire, but it's powerful desire. Sometimes it's a desire for good, and sometimes it's a desire for something that's not good, in which case it would be translated as lust. It would have those kinds of sensual overtones attached to it. But the same word can talk about a kind of longing or a passion for something that's good. And that's the use in this context. It's a passion for something good. If anyone aspires to be an overseer, he has a great desire, a passion for a good work, a noble task, a powerful something to do. Let's begin with then the idea of goodness. Goodness is one characteristic of the fruit of the Spirit. When the Spirit of God is working in our lives, He produces in us love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. All of those are characteristics of the fruit of the Spirit. And the Spirit produces that in our lives. We can't make that happen in our lives. We can't generate any of those qualities in our lives. We are wholly dependent upon the Spirit of God to produce that in us. So goodness that a deacon needs is produced by the Spirit of God, hence this connection with being a spiritual leader in the life of the congregation. Goodness comes from God by the very same grace that saves us. The grace that came upon you in the moment that you realized that you were a sinner and that you needed a Savior and that you put your faith in Jesus Christ was the grace of God that enabled that to come from you. You didn't have that in yourself. This simple belief was not something that you could generate or that you can build up or you can develop on your own now. This comes from God. So this goodness that comes from God comes by the very same grace that saves you. And so what occurs now is that a good man does a good work. A good man does a good work. And that's what we're looking for in those men that we call and choose to serve us as deacons. A second thing that emerges from the text is dignity. Dignity. Look at verse 8, and I'm going to read the rest, part of the rest of the passage here, and I'll highlight the part where dignity shows up. In fact, you'll see it immediately. Deacons, likewise, must be dignified. Not double-tongued, not addicted to much wine, not greedy for dishonest gain. They must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. And let them also be tested first. Then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. Their wives, this could possibly be translated deaconesses, their wives likewise must be dignified, not slanderers, but sober-minded, faithful in all things. Let deacons each be the husband of one wife, managing their children and their households well. I'm going to pause right there. We're talking about dignity. I just read a pretty lengthy list of character clues, of character qualities that we would like to see in the life of deacons and their wives. before us. But I'm not sure that we would be served if I came back and gave you a dictionary definition for each of those words. That might be a valuable personal study for you to do. And there are all kinds of resources available for you. If you want to go back to 1 Timothy chapter 3 and make your way to verse 8, start at verse 1 and read the character qualifications for a minister, an overseer. You could go through and work through all those thoughts and ideas, each one of those words, and it could be a very enlightening understanding. For these are qualities that are needed not only in the lives of deacons, but also in the lives of all God's people. So it would be a good thing. But I'm not gonna break down every one of those words today. Not in the exposition that I plan for you to do. So I don't think that you'd be well served by that. You'd probably forget most of that by the time you get out of here, which you probably will do anyway. That's just the way we were wired, okay? What does it take to become dignified in the way that Paul uses the word here? That's the question I want to ask. And so you got to know how he uses the word, what use of the word is. So he uses the word dignity to describe a man who is worthy of earthly respect deriving from his heavenly citizenship. It's because he's a citizen of the kingdom, because he's a member of God's family, that he has this kind of possibility of deserving this earthly respect. It's that because he has the Spirit of God working in his life, he has the possibility of so living his life, so ordering his life, that it would be characterized as dignified. That's what we're talking about here. This is the work of the Spirit of God in the life of that individual. Now, Charles Spurgeon said something very, very interesting. I read this months and months ago, and I wrote it on my board. I have a big white board in my study upstairs, and I write it, and I see it every day, and I'm reminded of this. He writes, "You cannot make a lantern shine brightly by polishing the glass. You must put a candle inside for the lantern to shine." There's got to be a light inside, right? That makes good sense, right? Just basic, you know, looking at a lantern and saying, yeah, that'd be really good if there was a candle in there making it shine, right? Polishing the outside of it doesn't change. Polishing the outside of a life doesn't make it shine with the glory of God. No, you cannot fake spirituality. You must have it from God. It must come to you as a gift from God. Verse 9, look at verse 9, says you must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. Now, I'm taken by that phrase, mystery of the faith, mystery of the faith. What's so mysterious about this Christian faith of ours? Well, the first thing that I can think of is it doesn't make sense. It does not make sense that the holy, righteous God, creator of the universe, the sustainer of all of his creation, who is himself holy and righteous in a way that is beyond our comprehension, beyond our ability to take it in, this holy and righteous God could somehow look upon us in all of our filth and sorrow and all of our sinfulness and love us and forgive us and make us his children? The wonder of justification by faith is that we put our faith in Jesus Christ and God declares that we are righteous in him. That doesn't make sense. So there are a lot of world religions and there are a lot of religious people in the world around us and there are a lot of so-called spiritual people in the world around us who are engaged in all kinds of activities trying to reach up and get to God, trying to build their own Tower of Babel to get to God, and not realizing that God has reached down to lift us up. It doesn't make sense because we want to hold on to the human effort, to the effort that we can give to reach God and to become pleasing to him. We could never do it. We could never overcome the gravitational pull of our sinful natures. And we can never overcome what's wrong deep down inside of all of us. But God, in love and mercy, has reached down to lift us up. That's what the mystery of the faith is all about. That's where our basic dignity comes from. Romans 6:23 says, "The free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." The free gift of God. Have you received the free gift of God? You can't do anything to earn it. You can only accept it and receive it by faith. I hope that's where you are. I hope that's where you've been. I hope that's how you live your life. I hope that's where you're going to go with the rest of your life, in the free gift of God. Dignity flows from applying this crazy gospel to your everyday life, taking this very wonderful grace of God to every aspect of what you do day by day. That's where your dignity comes from. It's the power of God working in you. Now, let's move on. Number three, brokenness. Characteristic of a deacon, of a spiritual leader, brokenness. You can't bypass this one. You got to go through this one. This one's tough. Verse 10 has the idea of tested, of being tested, and of proving oneself. So tested and proven is characteristic of the deacon. This is evidential in the life of the person that we want to serve as, want to serve us as deacons in the body of Christ. Tested and proven. Now, in the old cowboy movies, how many of you like old cowboy movies? I like old cowboy movies. I like John Wayne still. In the old cowboy movies, the cowboy gets his hand on a wild stallion. And wild stallions are okay. You know, there's a problem with them. They don't want to be corralled, and they don't want anybody on their back, right? And that's exactly what you have to do if you're going to make that a useful horse, right? You've got to change their mind about being corralled and about having someone on their back. That's what you got to do if you're going to make a useful horse out of it. So sometimes a cowboy will begin by just feeding the horse, taking him to water, providing shelter when it rains. And, you know, I don't know what a horse thinks. Neither do you. So let's just play with this. Yeah. I imagine a horse loves the blessing of being fed and watered and sheltered. Blessing, that's a good word, right? Yeah. And I'm sure if horses think, that's probably the word that they're using because they're so glad the cowboy is doing that for them. But so the beast may not mind, let's tone it down a little bit. The beast may not mind when the cowboy provides food and water and shelter, but the stallion does not want that cowboy climbing on his back. And that's exactly what the cowboy has to do in order to break the horse, he has to climb on and hold on for dear life, right? And in all the cowboy movies, those things buck and run and jump, and they don't do it like the guys at the rodeo on TV, you know, with one hand. They're holding on for dear life, right? They got to, right? And they've got to stay on it, stay with it, until the horse yields, right? And when the horse submits, it's broken, right? Broken. It's broken. Now, how do you tell that a horse is broken? You can't tell by looking at him. I mean, he looks just the same as he did before, doesn't he? And he is just as strong as he was before and can be just as stubborn and willful as he was before. But in this state, he is under somebody else's control. And all that strength and power that resides in the horse now has come to be under the control of the cowboy, someone else. In the Bible, that's a picture of the word meek, strength, under control. Now, God has to break us. There's not a servant in God's kingdom not a minister in any pulpit, not a genuinely serious spiritual leader in any pew who has not undergone the process of breaking, whereby God gets complete control of their life. It's painful, isn't it? Those of you who've been through that, it's painful. It hurts, doesn't it? Is there anything better in all your life, though, than to be under God's control? There's nothing better. There's nothing better than to be under God's control in that way. When the Lord breaks the beast that we are in ourselves and brings us into submission to Himself, where He can use us to bring glory and honor and praise to His name, something wonderful has transpired in your life. Now you can fight that all the rest of your life, and you may hold out. You'll be like a Jacob who tricked everybody along the way and lived for himself and only gave a passing nod to the glory of God in the living of his life. He finally came to a place where he wrestled with the angel of the Lord, and when the angel saw that he would not prevail and overpower him, though he could have any moment, when the angel saw that this guy was going to keep on fighting, he said, "Let me go, I'm gone. You can have your life." Poor Jacob realized, that's not what I want after all. And he grabbed hold of the angel and he said, "I'm not going to let go unless you bless me." And Jacob walked away from that wrestling match with the angel of the Lord with a limp for the rest of his life, as a reminder that God now has control in his life. Brokenness is a necessity in the life of a spiritual leader. Brokenness is an important part of the spiritual life of a deacon. Let me pass on to number four, vision. A deacon needs vision, don't you agree? A deacon needs vision. I enjoy watching home improvement shows. I wish I had some of those skills. I've piddled with refinishing some old pieces of furniture and all. I gave away the last piece I picked up when I was in seminary. Somebody else had set it out on the curb and it was painted ugly, and I stripped it down and sanded it and worked on it and dressed it up real nice. I was so proud of myself, you know. I finally gave that thing away, but, you know. So we're officially out of early seminary decor in the parsonage. But I like that kind of stuff. But you know, the renovation process always begins with demolition. You know, you got to clear out the old in order to make room for the new, right? And only once you get rid of the old can you begin to rebuild the new, right? Now, we're not talking about a new thing. We're talking about redoing an old thing, taking something and refurbishing it and making it useful again, or updating it. It's kind of what we're talking about when we talk about building this bridge to the community. I'm afraid that we need to catch the vision of what the bridge to the community really is, because I think there's some serious misunderstanding of what the bridge to the community is all about. If we're going to build a bridge to the community, does that not suggest to you that we want to reach out to the people around us? That we want to do something to go out into the city and out into the county and find people that we can communicate with, that we can connect with, that we can reach with the gospel of Jesus Christ? And a part of doing that is going to be some things like TrueLife.org, I'll be introducing that to the congregation in a few weeks, a way for us to invite people to come to church. And we're going to go out there and say, "Come, I want you to come worship with me." That's a part of building the bridge to the community. It's the outreach aspect of what we're doing. But another part of it is, what happens when they come here? We have guests in our house today. I applaud you. You made it to the auditorium. There's not a thing in the world that tells you how to get where you are unless you came in the front door. See, we're talking about building a structure that is the face of First Baptist Church for the community around us. That's the vision. But we miss the vision if we say, well, I don't want to do that. There's nothing in it for me. This is not about you. See, it's about the outreach. It takes the vision to understand what we're doing and not to look at it just through my eyes of what benefit there is to me. Here's another way to do it. We can't afford that. It's pricey. Why do we need to do that? Why do we need to do that? Well, let me tell you about somebody else who had a vision. Her name was Mary, and she had seen Jesus on a couple of occasions before and had become very friendly with Jesus. And he came to her home to have a meal, and she took a very expensive kind of ointment. It's called pure nard. I don't know what nard is, but I understand that a pound of nard in today's language is like 1 year's salary for a working man. So whatever income a working person would have made for a year, that was the value of this thing. And it had to be broken and poured out to be useful. And what she did with it is she broke it and poured it out liberally on Jesus' feet, and she wiped his feet with her hair. And there were people in the room who were not sure about this thing happening, and Judas was one of them. And Judas said, shouldn't we have sold that and gotten some money for it and did something to help the poor? Now, John knew something that the rest of us wouldn't know, because some of us would jump on that in a heartbeat and say, yeah, that would be the great thing. Do something with it in ministry to somebody else, you know. That'd be a great thing to do with it. But John knew what we don't know. John knew that Judas was the guy who kept the money bag. And Judas kept the money bag, apparently, because he liked dipping into the money bag and putting it in his pocket. What's in that for me? Judas is saying. Why should we let that happen? You see the point I'm making here? The vision of reaching the world with the good news of Jesus Christ is a big vision. It demands real creativity, real insight into the plan and purpose of God. It's bigger than any one of us, and it is for hundreds, I'll say hundreds in our county, beyond us. It's not for us. That's the vision here. We need deacons with that kind of vision. Lastly, let's talk about great confidence. Look at verse 13. I dropped that a moment ago. I didn't read it. Verse 13 says, for those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. So the good man doing good work, growing in that work, will move ever deeper into this place of good standing both with God and with people, and will acquire a great confidence for the manner of life that they live, that they choose to live. Who doesn't want that? Who doesn't want to live confidently? A kingdom citizen, a servant of the Lord, a man a woman of God in a world that is desperately in need of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Amen? That's what we're looking for. Goodness, dignity, brokenness, vision, confidence in those who will serve as deacons. And you'll have the opportunity to cast your vote next Sunday for such individuals. Amen? Let's bow. Our Father, we thank you for grace, mercy, and peace through our Lord Jesus Christ. We rejoice that your presence is our joy. Your presence is our comfort. Your presence is our power. Your presence is for us. We pray even now that one soul may put their faith in Jesus and receive for himself the gift of eternal life. As you offer it in the power of your Spirit, may they be able to respond with faith to your glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together and sing. And if now is your moment to meet the Savior, I invite you to come. Don't hesitate. Don't put it off. It never gets any easier. But come and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior.
Just some